Hey, everybody, welcome back. Really happy to have you back here in the Cloud Native Platform session. Today, I'm really excited about this talk. This is one that I actually pushed for getting in pretty hard because I think voice-driven applications are a huge part of what we're going to be seeing in the future. But I'm kind of have this belief that 10 or 15 years from now, we'll be at this conference and we'll be talking about voice-driven development more and more often. But we're in the early days right now. And so Xavier Portilla has a really fun presentation for you on how to build and run Alexa skills on cloud native on Kubernetes with Terraform. And so just as a quick introduction, Xavier hails from Valencia. He has more than 5 years of experience in a wide variety of industries, ranging from healthcare to industry to education and research. And he's worked at everything from startups to some very, very large corporations. So he's going to step you through this really kind of cool topic about using Alexa skills on Kubernetes. And with that, I will hand it off to you, Xavier.
Hello, everyone, and thanks for joining my session. Today, we're going to talk about Alexa skills and Kubernetes. But first, let me introduce myself. I'm Xavier Portilla. You can follow on all my social media at Xavidop on GitHub, Twitter, YouTube, or Twitch. I am the main organizer of DevOps Days Madrid, infrastructure engineer at Voiceflow. Actually, I'm now Alexa champion. We know one of the most relevant Alexa developers around the world. I work on the Hyperloop project on SpaceX. In Los Angeles. And you can, if you want to learn more about me, you can click on my blog, xavidop.me, and there you can find all my resume and all of my books, talks like this one, and so on. I am Azure Content Hero and AWS Community Builder. And yeah, today we're going to start talking about Alexa. So let's start talking about its beginnings. Alexa starts at 2014. On 2017, there happened the first conference about Alexa and Alexa development. On 2018, arrived to Spain. In 2019, more than 135 million of Echo devices has been sold. And now 2021, it is available in English, German, Hindi, Japanese, French, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, and more languages are coming to Alexa. But yeah, we are going to talk about an Alexa skill. So what is an Alexa skill? An Alexa skill is just a voice app. The voice app is something that developers create to extend, to add more functionality to the to Alexa, either to Alexa devices, Fire TV devices, mobile devices. Is similar to the Google Action for Google Assistant, but in the Alexa world is called Alexa Skill. So an Alexa Skill has mainly two parts. The first part is the front end, which is the voice user interface of the Alexa presentation language for those devices that has a screen. For instance, the Echo Show device. So the voice user interface are the utterances that you create, and Alexa will understand and hear to interact with the user. And the Alexa presentation language is a pseudo language, something like HTML, but in JSON, where you can design cool screens for the Alexa screen-enabled devices. So for that, if we mix both the voice user interface, like interacting with Alexa using the voice and interacting with Alexa, seeing or watching what is happening on the screen, we are having a multimodal interaction. And yeah, the other thing that we have is the backend. So it's not only the frontend. Also, we have the backend. Alexa itself is just another AWS cloud service. So what is happening when you interact with Alexa, when you talk with the Echo device or with an Alexa-enabled device, you will see that that device will be turned on a blue light. The device will hear you. And when you stop talking to it, that voice, that sound will be sent it to the cloud, and then in the cloud are going to happen like some artificial intelligence processes. Then the voice will be, that sound will be transformed into a JSON, because the servers and the information services talks with plain text, not with audio files. So we have JSON there. And then Alexa will call the backend. So now we are on the backend, not on the frontend that I explained before. Then the backend will answer the user request, and it will obviously answer with a JSON to the Alexa cloud. The Alexa cloud will transfer that JSON into voice, and then that voice will travel through the cloud and goes to the Echo device, and then the final user will hear the answer from Alexa. And what about that backend? The backend usually should be, as we are working on Alexa and as we are working on AWS, we are going to use a serverless architecture that makes sense on this kind of applications. And the services, the main service that we're going to use is AWS Lambda, then AWS CloudWatch for the logs, to store the logs from the Lambda, AWS S3 to store the assets like MP3 files, MP4 videos, images, any kind of asset, and then DynamoDB to persist data of our end users between sessions. So that backend could be written in officially Node.js, Java, and Python, and not official in .NET. And you can deploy it in another backends like Heroku or Azure Functions. But yeah, what happened if I want to host it on Kubernetes? Why? Because maybe you have everything deployed on a Kubernetes cluster. You have all your production environment deployed in your production cluster, and you don't want to introduce another kind of architecture like the serverless architecture one, or you want to have like everything in the same cluster, or you want to store the information, everything within the cluster, and all the services that are accessing to that cluster should be in the cluster, not outside the cluster, like in an AWS Lambda. So for that, we have the tools to make it happen. Right now, the Alexa and Kubernetes, well, we are at a starting point to deploying an Alexa skill on Kubernetes. I think I am the first person in the entire world that is doing this. There are a lot of work to do, but well, I've made a lot of things, and there is a lack of documentation, but yeah. As I told you, there is a lot of things already done by me. In this example, we are going to use Azure Kubernetes services, and the architecture that we are going to deploy within a cluster is, if you remember the interaction that we were talking before, the when Alexa runs the artificial intelligence processes and calls the backend, instead of AWS Lambda, this is just a pull request, an HTTP RESTful pull request that will go to a Kubernetes cluster, and it will go to an Nginx load balancer. That load balancer, well, Nginx ingress controller within load balancer, it will send a request to a Node.js cluster. Sorry, Node.js service, and then Node.js will retrieve the information to a MongoDB. The Node.js and the MongoDB are in a Helm chart, and everything is deployed in a Kubernetes cluster. The other solution that I provided to you is exactly the same, but instead of deploying a MongoDB, is deploying a is using MongoDB Atlas, which is the cloud from MongoDB. So what is happening within the Alexa cloud? What is happening, like the recognition or how Alexa transforms the audio into text? So there are two main processes. The first one is the Alexa speech recognition or automatic speech recognition, the ACR, sorry, the ISR, that transforms voice into text, just transforming voice into text. And then occurs the natural language understanding process, which is recognize that part of the text and recognize the what the user is requesting to us. So that's the second thing. And then after that is calling our service. So what we need? We need transform the AWS Lambda into a web server. Then that web server put it inside a Docker image. Create a MongoDB adapter, because by default, as I told you, Alexa is using DynamoDB, not MongoDB. So we need to create a MongoDB adapter. Then create all the Kubernetes objects. Then put all of these together and configurable easily in a Helm chart. Then deploy the Alexa skill, the metadata of the Alexa skill, and then deploy the Alexa skill backend on Azure Kubernetes services, then test, and if everything is okay, just publish. So let's start creating the web server. So for that, the Alexa has an adapter. So we can move all our Alexa skill backend code written, for example, in JavaScript. We can use this adapter and create an Express.js node server. This is just an NPM dependency, and the code is very, very similar to the Lambda approach. So with that, we will have an Express.js adapter. We see the code. This is the code just for the Lambda, and using the, just to explain a little bit about it, is just the handlers, the error handler, and the request interceptors, and then just calling the dot Lambda. Here is exactly the same, but using the SDK Express adapter. So for that, instead of calling the dot Lambda, we are going to calling the .create method, and then using the Express adapter, we are going to create an Node.js server. There are also some solutions for Java and Python, for Java for Spring Boot, and for Python for Django and Flask, to do exactly the same, but for those servers and those languages, because are the ones that are supported officially by the Alexa team. Then we just need to dockerize the web server, just putting all the information in a Docker image, because we are going to deploy it in a Kubernetes server. So this is pretty easy. And the database. The database, as I told you, we are by default, the Alexa skills are using DynamoDB. And there is one adapter, official adapter for DynamoDB. Really, really easy. But you can create the adapters that you want because the Alexa, you only have to implement a persistent adapter class. And after that, you can just implement in that class, you can create the adapter to whatever database you want. For instance, I created one for MongoDB in JavaScript and TypeScript. This is a GSTS library for Node.js. So this is the persistent adapter, sorry, I said class, but this is an interface. So when you implement this interface, you only have to implement those four methods. And yeah, that's really, really, really easy in less like, in less than, I think 200 lines of code, you have your persistent adapter and it's available on my GitHub. And with that, you have the Amazon Alexa MongoDB connected natively because the Alexa skill will automatically call to those methods internally when you are going to store the data on the database and you are going to retrieve that. So easily you can create more adapters, not only the MongoDB that I created or the official DynamoDB. You can create it easily, one for Redis, one for the Firebase storage, Couchbase, CosmoDB from Azure, and I mean, Postgres, any kind of database engine that you want. So for the Kubernetes objects, as I explained before the Kubernetes architecture, we are going to use a pretty basic architecture, which is a Kubernetes ingress controller that will act as a load balancer. That ingress will redirect all the requests to the pods. To the services, which is our express Node.js service running the Alexa skill backend, and then interacting with the MongoDB database. So if we go a little bit deeper here, you will see that the clients are Alexa itself doing a pull request, calling to the Kubernetes ingress controller. That will be our express Node.js. And then that Node.js will access to the MongoDB, either the MongoDB deploy within the cluster or using MongoDB Atlas. And this is Kubernetes objects, and this is a Helm chart. You can deploy easily, not only in Azure Kubernetes service, you can deploy it in Elastic Kubernetes service from AWS or on GCP in the Google Kubernetes Engine, GKE. So yeah, for the next step is creating the Helm chart. The cool thing here is that the main feature that Helms provide to us, which is creating or transforming the Kubernetes objects into a template. So very, very, very easily, we are going to create templates, and with that, and using the Helm chart as a deploy artifact or deployable artifact, we can deploy it very easily into multiple clouds. As I told you, you can use it or deploy it in AKS, in Azure Kubernetes Services, but using the Helm charts and using the values to set the values in the Kubernetes templates, you can deploy it on EKS or GKE or whatever you want very, very, very easily. Another cool thing here is how are we going to deploy it? Yeah, that's very, very easy. Why? Because in my GitHub, you can find that everything is automated using HashiCorp Terraform, using infrastructure as code. So what I try to, when I try to do that is create all the Terraform files needed to deploy the entire Alexa skill backend and also the cluster. So in that Terraform files, you will find the cluster, either on AKS, GKE, or EKS, the Nginx ingress controller, the MongoDB handchart, and the Alexa Backend Express web server. The MongoDB handchart and the Alexa Backend Express web server are in a upper handchart, which is like an umbrella handchart that contains both handcharts. And easily you can deploy, and you can turn on or turn off the MongoDB handchart in case that you are going to use the MongoDB Atlas Cloud, or you are going to deploy your MongoDB the MongoDB itself within the cluster. And yeah, explaining or talking about it, what happened with the local development, because right now the Alexa team has a lot of things to do, like a lot of dev tools to develop your Alexa skills. But what about with this approach? So for that, I'm going to talk a little bit about DevSpace. DevSpace is a YAML file that will read your entire project and will deploy automatically your handchart changes, your Kubernetes manifest changes, and it syncs and creates a tunnel and doing a hot reload. So when you change a file on a JavaScript file on the Node.js Express server, the DevSpace will automatically detect the changes and will do a hot reload. You will see the logs, and also it has a cool UI. It is configurable just using a YAML file, so that's really, really cool. And this is a screenshot from the DevSpace UI. This is a web app, so you can access there on the web browser, and you can see here the logs from the pods. One here is the MongoDB and the other one is the Alexa skill itself, running in a local Kind Kubernetes cluster. So really, really recommended. And yeah, I think that's it. We have 3 minutes remaining. So yeah, you can see there are multiple solutions for the Alexa backend. There are also multiple databases. Obviously there are delay in response, because when Alexa has to call to a Kubernetes cluster, you have to move away from the AWS cloud. So it can create some delays. And well, at the end, it's the same result, but with different approach. Some recommendations, the Alexa champions that are Joaquin, Nieves, Javi, and Lucio, and now I am one of the Alexa champions. The Alexa community from Spain, at Comunidad Alexa. And then again, follow me, my blog site, xavidob.me, my podcast for those Spanish speakers called Interior de Alexa, my YouTube channel. Also follow me on social media at Xavidob, and the official accounts of the Alexa developers like Twitter, Twitch, or YouTube. And we have a Discord here, so yeah, make a screenshot. And also I will be in a Q&A session afterwards, so if you have any questions, just ping me there and I will answer all of your questions there. And just to finish, I just write the two books. The first one is the called La Revolución de Alexa. And the other one is actually the same, but in English, called The Alexa Revolution. So this is the first book about Alexa development, written in English and in Spanish, 500 pages, 18 chapters, where you can learn from the scratch how to develop for these devices, and you will go deeper and deeper, and you will become an Alexa expert. So that's it. Thank you so much for joining my session. And yeah, see you in the Q&A session afterwards.
Thank you so much, Xavier. That was that's really cool. And we are very excited to see voice-based programming kind of grow in popularity, voice-based applications growing in population. And this is going to be really fun for people to play around with in the Kubernetes community. Reminder that Xavier is moving to the Slack channel to take questions and for any open discussion, comments that you may have. You can find that in the Spring One Slack under the session-voice-applications-alexa-skills-cloud-native channel. But I tell you, it's way, way easier if you just go to the breakout session page for this session and click on the Join the Discussion link that you can find right there. So I hope you got a lot out of this talk, and I hope to see you in some of the future Cloud Native Platform Track talks in the future, and have a great day. Thank you.